Hi everyone, I'm Stephen Mifsud, and today we're going to talk about a project that we've been working on with the City of Allen. We're going to talk about the approach to the project, the parks that we've inspected, and some of the findings and recommendations. Here I'd like to invite my colleague David.
Thank you, Stephen. My name is David Butkus. I'm here representing Cole & Associates, and I'm an accessibility project manager with the group. Cole & Associates is a full-service engineering firm, planning, survey, landscape architecture, and we also have a dedicated service line to ADA self-evaluation and transition planning, so it makes us a bit of a unique engineering group. We've been in the accessibility space for over 10 years now, and we've done self-evaluation transition plan projects for roughly 30 Title II agencies across the country of all shapes and sizes, down to townships all the way to a state level. Here within Texas, we've done work for TxDOT, Plano, Richardson, and Houston.
We are DARA Taxa, so we are International Accessibility Consultant, and we have 5 offices throughout the world, from Florida, Boston, England, Scotland, and in Dubai. What's unique about our firm is that we are a team of people with disability, and we provide accessibility audit, accessible policies, and also accessible product. I'd like to invite Courtney, who is one of our access consultants, to talk through the next slide.
I'm Courtney Hansen. I'm an accessibility consultant with Direct Access, and Direct Access likes to focus on going beyond compliance and looking towards inclusion. That includes people who use mobility devices or wheelchairs, people who are visually impaired, people who have hearing impairments or are deaf, people who have invisible disabilities, such as autism, ADHD, sensory processing disorders. That also includes families and kids, people who are elderly, people who have temporary physical disabilities such as breaking a leg or using crutches, and that also includes women who might be expecting.
Thank you, Courtney. So just going back to that slide, we didn't just want to achieve ADA compliance here. We want to look towards inclusion because accessibility benefits everybody. If you look at this slide, at some point in your life, you will probably be one of those rare people. Now, with this project, we didn't just want to turn up at a park or a facility and then start looking at the accessibility once we arrived. We wanted to look through all the lenses. So we take a 4-pillar approach to the project. So that is looking at the physical environment, which is the width of the sidewalk, the heights of steps, the digital environment, the website, what information do you have before you go, the social environment, the training of the staff, the awareness of people with disabilities, and also the sensory environment. So when you cover all 4 of those elements, you can then create true inclusion. Another thing, with this project, we didn't want to just start looking at the accessibility as soon as we arrived at the park. Accessibility starts at home, and it starts from when you start considering to go, organizing to get there. So how are you going to get there? What transportation? Does the website give you the information? Then when you arrive at the City of Allen site, what do you find? Then the experience of the site. So the seating, the rest area, the signage. Then you leave the site and then you return home and you go on social media and you talk about your experience. Is the social media accessible? Are we using Camel Key? Do we have captions on videos? So the point is, accessibility is not when you arrive. Accessibility is from home to the site and then back home. And that is the approach we took. This project consisted of many sites. So this was the pocket park, the mini neighborhood park, the community park, the regional park, all the way to the natural areas and the green belt and the open spaces. And part of this, we also included the Texas Event Center. Now I'll pass you over to David to talk about Cole's approach to the project.
Thank you, Stephen. Cole's role in the project was to do data collection and assessment for the sidewalk and hard surface trails within the sites that were a part of the scope of the project. So the image we see on screen here is a picture of one of the parks here in Allen. And what we did before we started the project was to work closely with the city to identify exactly where we were going to be collecting information, and we created these maps. So you'll see that the park is shaded in with a green, and in certain areas there's a blue line running throughout. This is what identified our collection within a park. Cole collected exterior accessible routes within park boundaries and also hard surface trails within park boundaries. We say hard surface because we didn't collect anything that was dirt or gravel, which would inherently be not ideal for someone who is using a mobility device or an individual with a disability, just depending. The criteria we applied during the evaluation were two pieces. One was the 2010 ADA standards, and all elements that we assessed during the project were in alignment with the 2012 Texas Accessibility Standards. And we also applied the Public Rights-of-Way Accessibility Guidelines, or the acronym there is PROAG. We use this for shared use paths or pedestrian ways, which are intended to be used by multiple modes of transportation. So bicycles, skateboards, walking pedestrians, there's more than one user there. And also for routes immediately adjacent to a public street. The things we were looking for when we were collecting were the running slope and cross slopes of that route. So the running slope is the slope of the walkway in the direction you're traveling, whether up or down. And the cross slope is the slope of that route perpendicular to your direction of travel. So just imagine yourself tilting left or right. That's a cross slope. Uneven concrete, so if there was any heaving or potential items that could pose issues for someone using a mobility device or any user really. Gaps in route connectivity, so was there a stretch of trail where there was a missing prepared surface between two segments? And obstructions, so were there tree branches overhanging the pathway? Was there a bush or a shrub overgrown, restricting the width of that pathway? And what we used to collect all this was a unique piece of technology we call the ULIP ADA. So the city of Allen decided to take a progressive approach to this and use a technology that allowed for incredibly efficient and accurate data collection. So our ULIP ADA here is a Segway equipped with a gyroscope and some lasers for measurement. So it's incredibly accurate and we're able to do this project quickly and efficiently. It takes 10,000 readings per second. So we have continual data collection. And the reason why that's valuable to the city and to the citizens of Allen is that it allows us to know precisely at any given point in a stretch of sidewalk or trail what the slope of that route is. And it allows us to create these maps, which you see on the right. So we took that information and then we boiled it down to something that's a little bit more digestible. So you could look at a particular site, and then the image we see on the right here, we have a high priority, medium priority, and low priority, in reference to things that may be outside of the standards, and it allows the city to make pragmatic decisions about what they might fix first or what they might remediate first. Our summary of findings from this collection, across all sites, what we collected throughout the city was 63.47 miles of sidewalk, and that included some of those shared use paths I mentioned earlier. Overall, the city is in a very strong position, as you can see with the table on the left here with the sidewalk and trail running slope. 98% of the sidewalk that we assessed was in compliance with the standards applicable for that. There was only 0.07 miles of missing sidewalk segments or connectivity gaps, as I mentioned earlier. And on the bottom right-hand side of the slide, we have an image showing you again what the run slope is. That's the slope of the pathway in the direction that you would be traveling. The cross-slope findings across the entire data collection set, again, very strong information coming in here for compliance. 61% was within the 0 to 2% standard. 31% was slightly outside of compliance. And what I mean by that is it was below 4% and above 2%. The reason we break it out this way is it represents usability. So there is a difference between something that's non-compliant and something that's not usable. So in our research and our experience in this industry, that 4% cross slope is still a usable cross slope. It's not ideal, and it should be addressed, but it's not your highest priority. In terms of the highest priority, there's 8% of what we collected, or roughly 5 miles, was above 5%. Overall, pretty good findings and a very strong position for the city. Some of the areas here, we had some poor surface conditions. We illustrate that on the bottom right-hand side of the slide here. We see a sidewalk panel that's cracked. There's some grass growing up there. There was about 113 damaged panels in the inventory. The a change in level on the sidewalk is essentially between two panels. One of them, they're not plain. So it's potentially something that could be tripped over or caused a barrier for someone using a mobility device. We collected over 1,200 of these instances, but again, there's a difference between the standard, which is a quarter of an inch vertical or a half inch beveled, and something that is truly a barrier to access. And the way we represent this data here is in line with that. So things that were below an inch, as far as that change in level, accounted for 1,224 of those instances. So the vast majority of these are below an inch. They're also relatively easy to fix in comparison to those which are above an inch, and that represents 17 of those. As far as obstructions, what I mentioned earlier about overhanging tree branches or overgrown bushes, there's 142 in total. The majority of these were low vegetative obstructions. That'd be like a bush or shrub. 45 of these were overhead, so imagine a tree branch, but all in all, in pretty good position with what we found out there, primarily accessible facilities there. Okay, back to you, Steve.
Thank you so much. So, in this project, we had direct access, looking at the facility, the experience of the site, and then we had Cole looking at the sidewalk. Let's be clear. Most of the site is very, very good when it comes to ADA compliance. The shortfall was minor. However, the City of Allen doesn't just want to comply with the ADA as it should, but go for inclusion and make these sites go beyond, because these sites are for you. So the summary of our finding. A lot of our findings are what we call blue sky thinking. And that is inspirational ideas that we can take and bring from our international experience. The first one was the website information. 80% or people with disabilities can research a venue, a site, or a building, or a park before they even go. So we need to make the information on the website as descriptive as possible so that people with disabilities, you, anybody, whoever you are, know what to expect and what facilities are available. When you put in an address of a site, it just takes you to the site. It doesn't take you to the accurate point of access. So we are recommending using what three words. And by putting what three words in, it gives you a 1-inch accurate place to go. So you can park your vehicle straight where the path is and get instantly where you need to go to. With the park, one of the consistent issues that we came across, and it's not unique to the city of Allen, it's unique to England, where I come from, everywhere we worked with, we have wood chipping. Now, while this is ADA compliant, as long as the correct pressure is there, it's not really a surface that everyone can find easy to use. So we are recommending that the City of Allen consider using harder surfaces, known as PIS, which is a poured-in surface. This doesn't just help wheelchair users. It doesn't just help people walking on the surface. We can also include visual aspect, colours, make these parks more inspiring places to play. Wayfinding. Everybody should be able to use these parks, and that's people with low vision. So when you have a large park, such as Bethany Lake Park, there's quite a lot of trail, pathways, sidewalk. Where is everything? So for people with low vision, we are recommending that we have tactile map, which also feature Braille as well. You see, wayfinding and the park should be inclusive for everybody. Same again for the fantastic trail markers. I'm very jealous here in the city of Allen and in this region. We've got some of the most fantastic trails. Everybody should be able to use and enjoy these trails. The issue we have at the moment is that the trail markers with the map that show you where you are, they're flat. So not it doesn't provide interpretation for everyone. A solution to that is to provide them in tactile and braille as well. Let's not exclude anybody. Same again for paper tactile map. I'd like to invite Courtney to talk about communication boards.
So what we have here up on the screen are some examples of communication boards. So we can make a park physically inclusive. We can do poured-in surfaces. We can do ramps on the playground. But I think what most of us think about when we were younger and playing on playgrounds is interacting with our friends, engaging with our friends, sharing those experiences. And a lot of kids don't communicate the same way. You know, as human beings, we all communicate in so many different forms. And these communication boards can be installed on playgrounds, and they can just give kids an opportunity to connect with each other, even if they don't use mouth words, even if they aren't speaking it for any number of different reasons. They can still, you know, invite their friends up there and talk about what they want to play. So by adding these communication boards to our playgrounds, we really are making playgrounds inclusive to everybody. Not just being able to get up on the playground and play, but being able to socialize and engage with your friends, which is, you know, such a great shared experience for all those kids on the playground. So back to Steve.
Thank you, Courtney. Everyone should be able to use the playground. Everybody should be able to visit every city of Allenside, regardless of who you are. Let's make this happen. Play equipment. We need to think about providing provision for wheelchair users. So some of the things we come up with in our report are swings, which is accessible for wheelchair users, and also roundabout. Let's be clear. So the ADA compliance to the ground level component, to the raised component, and all ADA compliant, we did not find fault. However, these existing structures, no matter how fantastic they are, we can tweak them and make them even better and more inclusive. For an example, here you see a flight of steps. If you have low vision, you may find it difficult to differentiate between the edge of the step. So, let's highlight them. Seating. The park have a wealth of seating, and it's absolutely fantastic. Our report have covered a lot of the different types of seats, so whether you've got benches, circular tables. We think that these could be updated, particularly here in this photograph. If you look at it, everything is yellow, so it's quite difficult to differentiate the table between the seat. So we add color contrast. A lot of the recommendations are the simplest things. And quite often with accessibility, it can be the most simple adjustment that will make a huge and significant difference. So for an example, here we have a trash can, then the wheelchair space, then the bench. It is much better to have the wheelchair space free and put the trash can on the other side. Can you imagine in the summer you have insects and you know you can't avoid that. We have turned the park upside down to ensure that we provide an inclusive experience for everybody. And this is all the way from the seating, the sidewalk, the communication board, the color contrast, all the way down to how do we book the pavilion. So as you know, the park, we have a wealth of pavilion that can be hired for such as birthdays, parties. At the moment, if you want to reserve a pavilion, you call a number. However, what if you have a hearing impairment like myself? That's not an accessible solution. So what we're recommending is having a QR code. So you scan the QR code and that links straight to an online form where you can book the pavilion. Splash Park. So here, Celebration Park, we've got a fantastic splash park. But some people may not be able to use it, such as wheelchair users. So what we're suggesting and proposing to the City of Allen, if they consider having a waterproof wheelchair available for rental, every facility should be accessible for everybody. The Credit Union and Texas Event Center, a fabulous place. But and we've got lots of restrooms, ADA compliant stalls with the required dimension. But what about people who have more severe mobility disabilities? People who require a personal assistant to help them. We are recommending something which is gathering steam throughout Europe and some places in the US, which is called a changing places facility. This does not mean a room to get changed. It's just a term and name for this facility. And in these facilities, you will have a height-adjustable bench, height-adjustable hand wash basin, a hoist system, a shower, a much larger and usable space to ensure that anybody can attend the events that are being held at the Credit Union and of Texas Event Center. Courtney.
So what we have here up on the screen are some examples of some sensory regulation spaces. Sensory environments are kind of how we take in sights and sounds and noise and how we process those so that we can use environments or engage in environments around us. So by having spaces like this that appeal to different kinds of sensory needs, whether it's visual or sound or tactile or kinesthetic, all these kind of different things, because we all have different sensory needs. So going into a space like this and finding something that can help you find your center and regulate yourself so that you can go back out and use the environments and the places around you would be really beneficial to have in the community. I know a lot of kids and adults even don't have accesses to these types of spaces, so it would be a really beneficial thing to have in the community.
Absolutely. Let's give people the tools that they need to enjoy the facility. Myself, as somebody who had a hearing impairment, it can be very, very overwhelming. Autistic individuals, they may just need that space for a sensory reset. Natural terrain solution. So here we have the trail of the woods, a fantastic place. Unfortunately, the natural terrain, and of which it should remain, because that's how it is. Not everyone can enjoy this at the moment. So again, like the splash park, let's provide the tool. So here is a Trek wheelchair, a motorized wheelchair. And this could be for rent, available for rent from the City of Ireland. Here you have Hillside Wellness Park, fabulous place where you can go and you can exercise, flex those muscles and get fit and all, just enjoy the park. Each of the play equipment on there had really good pictorial information, and there are instructions on how to use the equipment. But this interpretation may not be accessible for everybody. What if your first language is sign language? What if you have low vision or you're blind? These instructions would not be accessible to you. So what we've come up with is providing QR codes. And here is a sample. So for instance, the one on the top right, you scan, and then you would get audio description. You would get the information in an audio format. At the bottom right, the same again, but this time you get sign language. So by providing the pictorial information, the audio description, and the sign language, everyone can use the facility. Here in Ireland, you have a bundle of wildlife, bird, you name it. Let's make sure that everyone can enjoy that and appreciate that. So here we have a bird, for an example. If you have low vision, you can't interpretate what this bird shape is. So let's provide it in tactile form. Let's make this accessible for everybody. The Heritage Center has an amazing steam train. I couldn't believe it when I saw it. Huge, grand, fantastic. However, if you have low vision or you're blind, you can't appreciate this. So, the solution? Let's provide it in tactile form. You see, with this project, Cole and Dorit AXA, yes, we looked at the ADA compliant, but we really wanted to go way beyond that and think outside the box and come up with blue sky thinking. This is a hidden disability sunflower lanyard. So one of the biggest barriers to disability is if you have a hidden one. So the sunflower lanyard, which is starting to be recognized in the US at airports and large places, throughout Europe certainly, basically you wear this lanyard and it says, I may or may not require assistance. I have a hidden disability. Bear with me. I wear one with my hearing impairment, and it helps significantly. And we are recommending that the City of Allen consider adopting this scheme. Restroom facilities across all the sites, they are ADA compliant. The stalls had the required 60 inches, the maneuverability, everything was great. However, with this project, we look towards international experience, international expertise, colour contrast. So we have the baby change. It had Braille, which is great. However, the unit is the same colour as the tiles at the back. The same with the stall doors. If you look at the stall doors on the top right, it's all one colour. And then the ADA stall can be quite difficult to distinguish. So some people will walk through all the stall doors pressing to find out which one it is. So in this project, we've recommended adding colour contrast within the restroom. I'd like to say thank you for your time to watch this presentation. But I'd like to remind you, whilst we are so inspired by the City of Allen's approach to this project, and we have experience in accessibility, that's not the most important thing here. The most important is you, your feedback. We want to hear from you. These parks belong to you, the community. We can make these recommendations, but what is it you want to see in your park? We invite you to provide your feedback, and we will provide the feedback and give you the opportunity to provide the feedback in a way that worked for you. Thank you very much.